You're listening to Dave's Gone By. You're obviously a very lonely person.
There goes the neighborhood.
You got David Lefkowitz here. He's a Long Island arts guy. He's got his own radio show.
Welcome on this December 31st, 2009, to the 323rd episode of Dave's Gone By. Happy end of the year and beginning of 2010. I hope it's been a good year for you. Mine has had some pretty wild ups and downs, but definitely ending up on an upswing, which isn't a bad way to finish a decade either. And boy, we have a wonderful way to finish this year of episodes of Dave's Gone By. We've got two great guests. One of them is Marshall Efron, whom you'll remember from television stuff like The American Dream Machine, and he also did a one-person TV show on Sunday mornings called The Simplified, Illustrated, and Painless Sunday School. Maybe you remember that. I hope you do. Now, he's here, and also his longtime writing partner, Alfa-Betty Olsen. Now, not only can we talk to them about working together, but she was a very important part of the collaborative process on a movie you might have heard of called The Producers. That's right, the original Producers, directed by Mel Brooks, one of the great comedies of all time, and she had a huge hand in it. So it's going to be great talking to Marshall and Alfa-Betty, and also we'll begin the show with the satirical news gone by for the year gone by. So it just remains for me to thank our wonderful sponsors, Performing Arts Insider, the Bible of Broadway, also TogoTheater.com with hundreds and hundreds of theater reviews and feature stories, Hewlett Minuteman Press, the copy kings of Broadway, and Fancy Schmancy Balloons for all your party decorating needs. We'll be back with the last episode of the year of Dave's Gone By, The Marshall Plan, right after these messages.
Marriage, Babies, and the End of the World. It's a book. It's funny. I know, because I wrote it. And you should buy it at my website, davesgoneby.org. Are you reading me? What's black and white and red all over? Photocopies made at Hewlett Minuteman Press, the copy kings of Broadway. Any job that you have, including black and white copies, and they've got a brand new color copier, great quality, good prices, wonderful family that has owned Hewlett Minuteman Press since the 1970s. So check them out, 516-569-5577, Hewlett Minuteman Press. They're the kings.
Wake up the global stars!
My radio's on, the news is all bad, but it's good for a laugh.
Welcome back to Dave's Gone By on this late December night. It's time for the news gone by of the year gone by. A look at local and world events that shaped our year, taped our tears, scraped our fears, and raped our rears. In world news, well, our terror threat level is stuck firmly in orange, thanks to Umar Farouk Abdulmutallab. Gee, go figure someone with that name would be a terrorist. Umar was on a Delta flight a few weeks ago when passengers saw him trying to light his leg. They heard a popping noise, and suddenly he was on fire. Kind of sounds like me after Mexican food. But old Umar made it bad for the rest of us, because immediately after that, airport lines got longer, there was more screening, more searches, probably more delays. Just when we had an administration in place that might have reconsidered the idiocy of everyone taking off their shoes going through the conveyor, now they'll probably make us take off our pants as well. Which, I guess, is good news for anyone on the same flight as a women's soccer team. But meanwhile, they're investigating Umar's ties to Al-Qaeda operations in Yemen. Great. Yemen, another Muslim country to worry about, because Iraq, Iran, Syria, Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, Afghanistan, and half of Pakistan weren't enough. But the best part of all this is just 2 days after Christmas Day, when Umar failed in his little fireworks escapade on Delta Flight 253, another Nigerian man, on the same Delta flight, different day, but same hours, same itinerary, Amsterdam to Detroit, another Nigerian man causes a problem. Only this one was a false alarm. Poor bastard. This is from the Australian Herald Sun. Quote, a second Nigerian man taken into custody after an incident on a flight from Amsterdam to Detroit was, quote, just sick and not a threat. The plane landed safely and the man was detained, unquote. They said the reason everybody got nervous was that he was being verbally abusive. But listen, reports suggest he became abusive after being extracted from the bathroom while still unwell. Wouldn't you become abusive if someone was dragging you out of the crapper before you were finished? A poor guy. I can just imagine the dialogue back and forth. Air marshals, sir, we need you to come out of there. No, go away. I am busy. Sir, it's been 20 minutes. I may need 20 more. Sir, you need to evacuate. You are telling me. No, I mean the passengers are worried about an explosion. Oh, God, so am I. Sir, we'd like to know if you have any demands. Yes, can you bring me my Quran? Your Quran? Are you saying a final prayer? No, I'm out of paper. And so on and so forth. Also on the religious front, well, you gotta feel a little sorry for Pope Benedict XVI. He's always walking in the shadow of John Paul II, and no matter what Benedict does, John Paul always seemed to do it bigger and better and get more PR for it. Even getting assaulted. We all remember when John Paul was shot by a crazed Turkish assassin. It was round-the-clock news everywhere. The Pope nearly died, and yet 2 years later he visited the lunatic in prison and pardoned him. More headlines. Now look what happened Christmas Eve 2009. Pope Benedict XVI was making a procession to do his early mass on Christmas Eve. And there was some controversy about that, because all the other popes used to do masses at midnight. But Benedict, he's 82, he's a bit frail, so he's like, 10 o'clock, 12 o'clock, what's the difference? It's midnight somewhere, right? Ironically, for an ex-Nazi, he's amazingly like an old Jew. He's doing the Florida dinner mass. You start praying at 4:30, and you're home in time for Katie Couric. Anyway, His Eminence is doing the procession toward the main altar of the Vatican, when a woman jumps the barricade, knocks down a cardinal, and then knocks over the Pope. Neither was hurt, although the cardinal was taken to the hospital for a checkup. The woman, said to be mentally unstable, was arrested by Vatican police. Never occurred to me that there would be Vatican police. I mean, what are they carrying, like nunchuck crosses or mitres full of tear gas? Anyway, it's carried on all the news channels, but it's forgotten by Christmas afternoon. The Pope had continued with his service and didn't even make mention of the incident, which I guess is appropriate. The Pope should do nothing when a woman knocks him down, because for centuries the popes have told women to do nothing when they get knocked up. Also in Christmas time news, there are two holiday traditions in Stockholm, Sweden. The first is to erect a giant straw goat in the town square. The statue represents the traditional Yuletide goat, a kind of seasonal mascot there. So, since the 1960s, they put up this jumbo-sized Christmas goat made of straw. And then tradition number two, vandals come and burn the goat down. No matter what authorities do, hiring guards, putting in security cameras, one time they even coated the goat with flame-retardant chemicals. But that much just made the statue look so disgusting, nobody wanted it in the town square. So they've just gone back to the honor system. And what do you know, the thing got burned down again. Said the chief of police, quote, it's a tradition to burn it down. It's been burned down more years than it survived, unquote. I know, at this point, it does sound as much a tradition to torch the goat as it does to put it there in the first place. In fact, the only ones who complained about the loss of the straw goat were the police and a handful of really horny scarecrows. Speaking of vandalism, here's the most upsetting news story of the week. Five men were arrested in Poland last week for stealing the Arbeit macht frei sign off the front gate of Auschwitz. That's right. Perhaps the most iconographic artifact of the Holocaust was cut into three pieces and stolen by a gang of thieves. Ironically, the men who stole the sign that means work makes free were too lazy to hide it well, so they got caught immediately. What's really creepy is that the criminals were not neo-Nazis or making any kind of political statement. However, they were hired by a group of Swedish terrorists trying to raise money for their cause. Swedish terrorists. What do the Swedes have to complain about? I hate snow. I'm going to blow up the parliament. And, I mean, what is Swedish terrorism? Hiding the last reel of a Bill Gottsjuman film? Actually, for some, that can be counted as a humanitarian act. In science news, congratulations to three inventors from Chicago who have won an award from Harvard University for 2009's most eccentric research. They invented a brassiere that can double as a pair of gas masks. Each of the bra's cups has a filtering device. So presumably during one of those Sarajevo beauty contests, the ladies can whip off their tops and be ready for any kind of police or military onslaught. The gas mask bra won the public health award given from the Ig Nobels. Get it? Ig Nobel? Put out by the kids at Harvard University who obviously have nothing better to do. Actually, I have nothing better to do because this is really cool to talk about. Other Ig Nobel winners include three Mexican researchers. They created diamonds out of tequila, which the Polish community members thought was a terrible waste of tequila. There was also a prize for Dr. Donald Unger, who cracked his knuckles for 60 years just on one hand. He did it to see if the warnings were true, that knuckle cracking causes arthritis. Well, it doesn't. Or at least not on him. Both his hands are fine. The Ig Nobels also honored two English researchers who discovered that cows who have names give more milk, unless you name them Marvin or Spike. The Peace Prize went to a group of Swedes who proved that in a bar fight, empty beer bottles are more dangerous than full ones. I don't want to know how they discovered that. Now, the Literature Prize, this is great, the Literature Prize went to the Irish National Police, who issued 50 tickets to a man whose name in Polish means driver's license. And then there's the Biology Award, which went to three Chinese guys who demonstrated how bacteria in panda excrement can reduce kitchen waste by 90%, which is brilliant because really, who wants apple peels and empty cereal boxes and corn cobs in your kitchen trash? I would so much rather have a hefty bag full of bear waste. And speaking of bear wastes and bear everything else, we have the invariable naked man story. Here's this story from the Daily News. A crazy man stripped naked in front of a polling place in Brooklyn. He then ranted to a group of campaign workers that he was the son of Jesus Christ. Said one worker, quote, "He was butt naked. He walked up on us like he was on drugs, and he was saying he was the baby of Jesus." He also said he was 5% Muslim. And I love the other details of this story. Quote, "Cops arrived and took the nude and nutty man." Isn't that a great phrase? "The nude and nutty man to Long Island College Hospital for psychiatric evaluation. Before the kook ditched his clothes, he had been sitting in a beat-up white Infiniti with California plates. Later that night, the car was still there, but the back window was smashed, and there was a pair of blue jeans and a yellow tie in the back seat." And my wife wonders why I have no desire ever to move back to Brooklyn. But I hope the baby Jesus fellow is okay, because we are in the middle of Christmas time, and kids are so tired of mall Santas. That whole sit on Santa's lap thing is so 1940s Miracle on 34th Street to 1980s Christmas Story. What we need to do is hire some naked lunatics to go to Macy's by the perfume counter, march little kids up to them. "Jesus, can I have a new bicycle?" "No, little boy, but if I point my finger at the sun, you can eat all the buildings because they're made of meat." Jesus, why are you holding on to a shield made of tin foil? So the spies from Neptune don't steal my secret thoughts. Baby Jesus, you're scaring me. Oh, don't worry. The world won't end until I say so. Okay, now. In crazy Colorado news, because we get more than our share of crazy out here, the Denver Post reported that 29-year-old Aaron Siebers told police he was attacked and stabbed by three skinheads. Siebers was rushed to the hospital, but when police looked at surveillance video of where he said the assault happened, they didn't see anything. That's when Siebers confessed that he had stabbed himself. Why? Because he didn't want to go work that night at Blockbusters. Now, I'm sure it's not the best job in the world, but is it worth self-laceration? Especially if the guy's wound doesn't heal in 1 week, he gets 5 more days to either keep the stitches or pay a regauzing fee. And just to prove that not all crazy people live in Colorado, an Australian man was arrested last week when he was caught in a supermarket stuffing sausages down his pants. He tried to leave the store concealing the sausages in his shorts, but he was quickly spotted by 6 women who all gave him their phone number. Moving on to entertainment and health news, Autumn saw all 3 television networks combining to air the special Stand Up for Cancer. The celebrity studied event was meant to raise cancer awareness and the need for early detection. Going the furthest to champion the cause was Brad Garrett, the Everybody Loves Raymond star. He underwent an actual prostate exam on the air. Honestly, I don't object to the segment for its bad taste, but considering we've spent a year watching Glenn Beck, Dick Cheney, and Balloon Dad Richard Heaney, hasn't TV explored enough assholes? In publishing news, it was a nasty year at Condé Nast. The company officially shut down 4 of its magazine titles, Gourmet, Modern Bride, Elegant Bride, and Cookie, which crumbled. 180 staffers lost their jobs, although so far Vanity Fair, Vogue, and The New Yorker are still safe. That said, even legendary Vogue editor Anna Wintour wasn't spared the cost-cutter's axe. In fact, they're even making a new movie about her, The Devil Wears Kmart. Some sad news in the neighborhood. Singer-songwriter Vic Chestnut committed suicide last week. He took an overdose of muscle relaxers, went into a coma, and died Christmas Day at age 45. Chestnut released several albums over the past 2 decades and had fans ranging from Billy Corgan to Michael Stipe. But when Chestnut was injured in a car accident at age 18, it left him paralyzed from the waist down, which meant much of his offstage life was spent trying to pay medical bills. Even though Chestnut just came off a big North American tour, I guess life became a little tough to take, facing what he had to face. Asked about the funeral plans, his family told the press he was being cremated, or as they put it, chestnuts roasting on an open pyre. I'm sorry, but... Yes, however horrific, that is the sound of the comedy bell. Since Dave's Gone By began 7 years ago, we've rung the comedy bell to signal the Dave's Gone By bad pun of the week. Whenever we do the news gone by, we make a play on words so nutty, so cracked, that we come out of our shells to ring the comedy bell. Because the comedy bell reminds us that Dave's Gone By is the place to advertise your product, event, or service. Yes, we're coming out of the recession, hopefully, for the most part. So this is absolutely the time to redouble your efforts to get new customers, drum up new business, and spread the word of what you do, what you sell, and what you offer. That's where I come in, with a half minute or a full minute of advertising exposure on Dave's Gone By. You know, there's 3 keys to great advertising: repetition, humor, and repetition. People listen to this show, they pay attention, and after a couple of times, they'll remember you, and they'll think of you when they're ready to make that purchase. So email davesgoneby@aol.com, and we'll give you the great rates and greater ideas to bring your message to my listeners. It's as easy as ringing the comedy bell. davesgoneby@aol.com. Don't be good, be ponderful. Returning to the news gone by, I'm also sorry to report this obituary. One of those quirky, nostalgic semi-stars that we love died on December 20th. He was the voice of Top Cat and the Honey Nut Cheerios Bee. He was a regular on the Milton Berle Show, and he appeared in such films as Dandy, It's a mad, 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 mad world, and is Frank Sinatra's sidekick in The Man with the Golden Arm. Of course, I'm talking about Arnold Stang, who died of pneumonia at age 91. Yes, little squeaky Arnold Stang, all 100 pounds of him. Perhaps his most famous or infamous movie was Hercules in New York, where he was billed alongside another Arnold, Schwarzenegger. If you've never seen it, well, you've never seen it. Arnold Stang once described his persona as looking like, quote, a frightened chipmunk who's been left in the rain too long. All I know is that you couldn't hear Arnold Stang's voice without knowing it was Arnold Stang, and without getting a smile, because you knew this was the voice of someone who never meant anyone a lick of harm. There's a funny moment on an old Robert Klein album where Klein plays a freeform FM DJ, one of those late-night guys who's really smooth about everything but doesn't say anything, playing jazz and just basically being a brainless hipster. And Klein gets a nice laugh when the DJ comes back on the air and says, we just had a caller requesting more Arnold Stang. We'll get that on the air for you. Well, you know, I too wish there were more Arnold Stang. But much happier news to conclude the news gone by. We follow death with a new life. Congratulations to Van Morrison, Van the Man. He's become a daddy again at age 64. George Ivan Morrison III was born on December 28th. The mother, who is Van Morrison's manager, and the baby are doing just fine. And the father doesn't seem to mind that he'll be pushing 80 before the boy's old enough to drive. I guess there's two sides to this whole trend of old guys having kids, but I'll say this for Van. He obviously knows how to go back on top with warm love on a wild night and use his slim, slow slider on a sweet thing. And that's the news gone by for Thursday, December 31st, 2009. Please send your comments, opinions, and roasted chestnuts to Dave's Gone By, P.O. Box 31, Greeley, Colorado, 80632. That's Dave's Gone By, Box 31, Greeley, Colorado, 80632. We reserve the right to read your letters on the air, name withheld upon request. If you'd rather send an email, davesgoneby@aol.com. And even if you don't want your letter on the air, send us your screen name to join the weekly Dave Mail list, because each new episode we send out a cool, fairly amusing email about the next show, complete with pictures and quotes. It's very cool, it's free, and the mailing list is absolutely private. Only a select group of Nigerians with questionable passports get to see your information. So email davesgoneby@aol.com. We love getting your letters, postcards, packages. Send us anything, but please, no jokes about Tiger Woods' wife. I'm too old to go clubbing. Back after this.
And that was news. Yes, that was news. That was very, very, very special news.
Dave's Gone By wants you to advertise on the show. Reach our loyal audience with your message at prices you can afford even in this economy. Call 516-295-1511, 295-1511, or visit davesgoneby.org for info. You'll want us just as much as we want you.
Welcome back to Dave's Gone By, and when we think of the great teams in history, the Bogies and the Bacalls, the Samsons and the Delilahs, we have to, I guess, include in that list the Efrons and the Olsens, in a manner of speaking. Marshall Efron and Alfa-Betty Olsen have been a team involved in writing and humor and also television for, I guess, I don't want to overstate their ages, but it's got to be about 40 or 50 years now. Yes, Alpha?
No, since the Great American Dream Machine in 1972, I believe.
80, 90, oh, so it's only about 30, 40 years. See, I'm sorry I aged you prematurely already.
Yeah.
If people remember from public television The Great American Dream Machine, which came out only a couple of years after public TV was invented. It was, how to even describe it, like CBS's Sunday Morning meets Bill Maher meets Saturday Night Live. I can't even really think of the best way to think about it. It was all these little bits and pieces and segments, some satirical, some not. Marshall became sort of the face of it, one of the faces on the show.
I was the icon. That's what I got on that. But thank God they weren't paying me that kind of money that I deserved.
That you roundly deserve, but also you and Alfa-Betty. See, she was the writer on a lot of these pieces, or you co-wrote some of them. You were the front face of it, and I guess that also led to what I knew you best for, and I'll bet you a bunch of the listeners to this program did, if they watched television on Sunday mornings, and after all these religious programming in Fulton Sheen and Sunrise Semester and what have you, suddenly there was this one man doing these Bible stories, both from the Old Testament and the New, in a comical, bizarre sort of fashion, called Marshall Efron's Simplified...
Illustrated, Simplified, and Painless Sunday School.
Painless Sunday School.
We did 48 shows altogether, and then they repeated them from 1973 to 87.
Oh, it was all the way out through 87. I'm so glad that, like, two generations got a chance to enjoy that show.
Also, because of the show, we did a book for E.P. Dutton called A Bible Stories You Can't Forget No Matter How Hard You Try.
And that's available on ABE, if anyone has a computer out there.
You mean A Books, or ABE is something else?
It stands for Advanced Book Exchange.
Oh, cool.
You Google it, ABE.
It's ABE.com, and you can buy any book you ever dreamed of through that website.
How did you guys meet?
Well,
I hired her.
Yeah.
Was it really true? You needed a writer, or?
Marshall had, I had worked with Mel Brooks. I worked with Mel Brooks on the movie The Producers, the first movie, The Producers.
I've heard of it.
And I also cast it.
Oh my God, you know what? I'm not going to stop the tape, but we have to stop right there, Alfa-Betty,
sure.
Because just mentioning that, I need to sidetrack down that alley. I didn't remember that or realize that, so I've got to ask like two or three questions just about working on...
What about me? What, am I being abandoned?
Momentarily, yeah. This was supposed
to... Pride is on the line.
Well, when we get to the Sunday school thing, I'll get to you, Marshall, Sir Marshall. You want to be called Sir Marshall, is that
but
true?
But little is left of that ash that you...
I doubt that highly. But Alfa-Betty, how did you hook up, first of all, with Mel Brooks in a professional manner of speaking?
Well, I knew him, and one day he said, "You can type and I can't."
Okay, that's good. Right.
And I have to turn this in on Monday. And so we used the weekend and I typed.
Was it?
And
yeah. Did he recite everything to you and you just took it down, or did he have a
notes? Alfa-Betty doesn't take recitation.
Oh.
But she goes along.
No, it's more like, you know, when they were doing the show of shows, the Sid Caesar
sure.
show of shows.
Of course.
They had all those writers in one room. Neil Simon and Mel Tolkien and Mel and Carl Reiner. And in the corner, in the latter days...
Woody Allen, right?
Woody Allen.
Uh-huh.
And he was the guy on the typewriter. So whoever runs the typewriter has a lot of power, if you know what I mean.
Because you can accidentally forget to type the joke you don't like and edit as you please. Were you able to do so?
The typewriter is a weapon. But anyway, and it was a lot of fun. It really was a lot of fun.
I'll bet.
And the movie was made in New York on a very low budget, and it was really almost a home movie.
Well, he got Joseph E. Levine to produce it, so he got somebody.
Yeah, it was also at the same time as The Graduate.
Right.
And which was ironic, because Anne Bancroft, Mel's wife, was in The Graduate, which, you know, was their important movie.
Abco Embassy.
Yeah, Abco Embassy. So... Anyway, there are so many stories surrounding that entire episode.
Oh, I'll just bow out.
No. Don't go away, Marshall. Don't go away. I mean, yeah, I know you've probably heard these stories a million times because, you know, you're married to her, but I haven't heard them yet.
You're not married.
You're not married?
No.
Are you a couple or are you just professional partners?
No, we're just professional writers.
Oh, my
Marshall. Yep. And Marshall, of course, is a... performer.
I'm a performer.
Well, yes, I realize that. I always assumed you were a couple as well as a...
Bad assumption.
Right, a lot of people do that.
Right.
Yes.
You know, and for a long time we used to use the word partner, but now the word partner...
Right. You know, you figure...
Has bad connotations. So there's, there's nothing left.
Are either of you married?
No.
Oh, God.
Definitely so.
Okay. Do you think one of the reasons that you haven't gone on to marry other people is because as a partnership that fulfills everything you need from another person in your life?
No, I don't think so.
Oh, okay.
I don't know why. Do you know why, Alfie?
No, well, I was married.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. When we first started working together.
She's married.
Actually.
Huh. Okay. Forgive me, I didn't want it to veer off into another...
I'm not forgiving.
Actually, there are other collaborations like Condon and Green.
They were married.
Yes. They were married to other people.
So do you do the thing like you meet 4 or 5 days a week from 9 to 4 and you work...
And we live in the same building.
Yeah.
I'm on the 9th floor.
Uh-huh.
The 3rd.
Okay.
And we bless the 6 floors to separate us.
So, but is it true that you force yourselves to... I mean, it's a job. You go to work.
No, I wish we did. I wish there was a job where someone was paying us.
Oh, well, right. But how many hours a week do you put together, and how much do you work apart?
We work a lot of together.
Well, cool.
Don't we help any?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. It wastes a lot of time.
Well, that was always par for the course. I mean, you get a writer's in a room, the first hour is spitballing, the second hour is napping, the third hour is food. And then by about 4:15, it's like, hey, we have to put something on paper. And
like napping.
Napping's good. Napping's nice. Actually, one bit I remember vaguely, wasn't even much of a bit, but I'll never forget it, on American Dream Machine, you once went to a podium to answer the all-important question, is there sex after death?
And I answered it negatively.
Yeah, you just said no. You closed the book and you walked off. It was very disturbing in an interesting way. Just, I wonder if there's sex before death, because I'm married.
No,
I'm
kidding. With some people, it's dubious.
So how did you get the Dream Machine gig?
I came back from Spain, where I was doing spaghetti westerns.
Wow.
And I called up a friend of mine. I was very, I was heated. I was... not hot, but heated. I was ambitious, and I wanted jobs right away. I went to Spain to do the movie Doc. Frank Perry's picture was Stacy Keach and Faye Dunaway.
Okay.
And behind me on the seat, in the airplane, in the Sabina airplane, was Dan Greenberg and his wife, Nora Ephron.
Oh my gosh.
And I knew Nora from high school.
And you're not related, by the way, even though you have the...
No way.
I know, different...
I'll tell you.
Uh-oh.
Did I tell him, Alfa-Betty?
I don't know what you're going to tell
him. And you're not related to Zac Efron either.
He's his name Efron.
Ah, okay.
Here's what Efron... Efron is not a name that goes from Genesis 1823 down through the ages to become me, you know, ultimate... environmental, ecological, whatever, derivative. It's not that at all. Efron is the name that is given as a title to any middle-class Jew who endows a cemetery in Poland or Russia.
So, in other words, your ancestral name would have been very different from Efron, but you don't know what he
is. Schneider, Schneigelager, von Sutzschuschen,
So Efron goes back to Ellis Island, or just previous? Is that the deal, or...?
Russia. It goes back to Russia and Poland. Ukraine. It has to do with somebody in my background, some ancestor of mine, endowed a Jewish cemetery.
Now, would that have been the same for Nora Ephron's family, too? Even though, okay.
It all comes down to the Cyrillic, so an EPH, an EFF, an HEFF, EF, it's all the same. I'm not related to Zac Efron.
Right, okay. And nor I've forgotten about her, whom you were sitting in front of.
I can't run either unless she wants to be.
Right. No, God, I'm trying to do a straight line in this conversation, and there's no way. Dan Greenberg, he wrote How to Be a Jewish Mother, was sitting next to Nora Ephron. Are they related? Or they're just Jewish?
They're married. They're married to each other.
Okay, wow. I found somebody who is married.
Each other carnally, yes.
Okay. Now, you talked to them on the airplane. They were involved in Dream Machine. Was that the
deal? I knew them before. No, they had nothing to do with it. Dream Machine was a figment at the time. Dream Machine was not anybody's possibility at that moment when we flew out in August of 1970 to Almeria.
Okay. And so?
I was a contract player in the movie.
Right, in the Doc movie, yeah.
Doc.
Sorry, that one I don't remember. Unfortunately.
Why did you? You were not one of the seven who saw it.
I'm 45 years old, so there's certain things that were a little before my time, and certain things that, you know, I kind of caught up with. How did you guys get involved in Great American Dream Machine?
Well, I hired Alfa-Betty. My producer, co-writer, Betty, quit me. She's quit me. She's a girl in bed. I have been awarded a new show. I won't be working with you.
Oh. Man. Okay.
She's coming, little man.
Really?
So that was on a Friday. And Marshall and I had a mutual friend, Bridget Potter. And Bridget told Marshall to call me. So Marshall called me, and I perceived him as the star of the show.
Anyone else would have.
And by show business rules, I assumed he had the right to hire me. So he promised me that we would put internal rhyme into everything we wrote.
Yes.
And gave me the address. And I showed up.
You see, she just did it. She said, I said yes. She said address.
Very good.
And so I showed up for work on Monday morning. And it took 6 weeks to straighten the whole thing out. And I finally got a contract and got paid.
I'm wondering, did it ever bother you, Alfa-Betty, that Marshall was always the front face? Were you always comfortable just being the behind the scenes, whereas obviously the person who gets his face on camera becomes the more famous one and is credited for all the comedy and all the et cetera? When you were the co-writer.
Well, yeah. Well, that's what the job was.
Okay.
Neither Marshall nor I have the ability to affect that. You know, it's the people who sign the checks who make those decisions anyway.
Right, but maybe there was, let's say, when the decision was made to do the Simplified, Illustrated, and Painless Sunday School show, whose idea was it to have a one-person show?
Yeah, no budget.
No, remember, that was Marshall's idea. The concept was there was a Japanese performer.
He was Chinese.
And he used to do a one-man Hamlet. He did a Hamlet.
Uh-huh.
All the parts himself.
Okay, the death scenes must have been interesting. Okay.
It was sad. He used Laertes was a blow-up dummy with one of those things you kick at the beach, you know, it has a...
Yeah.
And he had a bottle of ketchup. So he would fight Laertes and then squirt ketchup on him.
That sounds wonderful, actually.
Out on the floor.
Yeah.
He was great. It was like one of the great shows of all time. He had studied both with Stanislavski and with the Chinese Art Theater. He was a great, great actor, and he was in 20th Century Fox movies.
What was his name?
I forgot his name, but he was in the movie The Purple Heart by Lewis Milestone.
Okay.
He played the bad Chinese guy whose son stabs him in the back.
Oh, okay. Well, yeah, I guess we can Google that or IMDb it. So you had this idea then, why not do, and did you approach CBS and say, we want to do Bible stories? I mean, where did that idea come from?
We had a wonderful agent at that time, Marion Searchinger. She's not with us any longer, but Marion was terrific. And she actually dreamed it up and talked the woman who ran that division, that part of CBS.
CBS News Religion.
Which happened on Sunday mornings.
Pamela Highland.
Into doing this. And in those days, television was much more relaxed and much easier and much more willing to take chances. And in the religious department, no one cared what they did
at all. And also, Pamela had autonomy for that reason. in the two and a half hours that she had, look up and live and lamp unto my feet.
Right.
So it was a much more experimental world. You know, the Dream Machine was very experimental.
But that was PBS.
That was PBS. But I mean, television was much easier then. Of course, it was corporations, but it was just more relaxed.
I don't recall. Did you have commercials on your show? I think it was straight through. Even.
Oh, we had a full 29-minute show.
Yeah,
what it was it fulfilled CBS's obligation to do public service. I think that obligation has disappeared now. They don't have to devote any time to anything called public, you know, that would be construed as public service. But then you could. So a lot of people, a lot of actors, made their first television appearances in this television time slot,
including James Dean.
James Dean?
And
he did the illustrated and painful Sunday School.
No, this was our show.
What was it? The 10 to 11 time slot on Sunday morning.
Or 10:30 to 11.
And they would do short plays. They would do all kinds of things.
Experimental stuff. They did a lot of good stuff.
I remember that. There were homilies, or there were fables that had kind of a meaning to them.
Or people in costumes. Or modern day. Paradigms.
Do you guys have a favorite sketch or bit that you did?
What they wouldn't let us do.
Oh, right. They wouldn't let us do this because they thought it would upset children.
Yes. I wanted to do what, where Jesus comes and resurrects Lazarus.
Yeah.
And
yes.
The sisters praise Jesus. Oh, Jesus, you brought our brother back.
Well, we were trying to put green makeup on, have him rise up out of a coffin. They wouldn't let us do that because they said it would upset children. He may have been right.
But it was such a loss.
Was that the only censorship you encountered on that show?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, God, I'm so sorry. You never taped it. They never even let you get it to. And not only didn't it run, you didn't even do the sketch, right? Or is it somewhere in a vault?
Oh, he said no.
Oh, they just said no.
But never done. The family said no.
Are those shows?
But our obligation. We do our obligation very well, so we weren't going to scuttle it by becoming nasty or dirty or, you know, weird or anything like that. Because the object was to do the show right.
Yeah, no, it was absolutely clean. I want to make that clear. Is it available anywhere?
We've dreamed that they might someday release them on DVD, and we do hear from people who ask, is it available anywhere on DVD, but so far it's not.
Do you have any of your listeners with any power whatsoever? any of your audio listeners, the people with big ears?
If they ever break out of prison, I'll definitely let them know.
Well, ask them in their prison cells to please write letters to CBS and say, release it.
So CBS still holds the rights.
Right. Good time, well served. Let Marshall Efron rise again from the dead.
Now, speaking of that, you did the show for 4 or 5 seasons. And then, what? I mean, there you are, you're present every week on television.
Did you ever hear of a movie called Ice Age 2?
Oh, I know you did a lot of cartoon voices.
Years of Who?
Right, yeah.
I also did a lot of voiceovers in the golden years of what's it called, half-hour television on Saturday morning kitty fair.
Oh, yeah.
Did a ton of that stuff.
And it's fun to bring this up because we just lost Arnold Stang, who was the voice of...
Well, I worked a lot with Arnold. I loved him. He's a great man. He's a really sweet person.
Oh, man. Yeah. Unfortunately, I never got to interview him or meet him, but there was just obviously something special.
Oh, you left New York. You left New York. It was your choice.
I only left New York 4 months ago. I could have done it before then.
Well, you should have.
You're right. But what were some of the characters?
He's always available. He's a gentle, real nice person.
Yeah, I just don't know how. I mean, he was really out of the limelight for the past 10 years, so I assumed he was rather aged and perhaps unwell. I didn't even know how to contact him.
No, we did a Honey Nut commercial. He was the voice of the Honey Nut Bee.
Yes, I remember that. And you were...
What was Estelle Harris.
Yeah.
I did a couple spots with them. I forgot what character I was. The honey.
Now, Estelle Harris, she was George Costanza's mother?
Yes, in Seinfeld.
Okay. And Marshall, what were some of the other cartoon folks that you did on Saturday mornings?
Oh, the Transformer. I've got hungry.
Oh, but also you were a Smurf.
I was a Smurf, yes. I was Sloppy Smurf.
You were saying, not even
And did a lot of shows, kid videos, Scooby-Doo. I mean, I appeared on a lot of shows as a guest, and I was regular on a lot of shows.
And Alpha, while Marshall was doing this, since you were the writer portion, were you writing books? Were you writing?
We did some books. Also, we wrote a movie for Disney, for Disney Television.
Uh-huh.
And we wrote some pilots that didn't lead to anything. And we wrote a few movies that didn't get made.
Is that heartbreaking, or do you at least get some sort of fee, on spec and...
You really do get paid for it, and it's to be biblical about it.
Well.
Many are called, but few are chosen.
Aye.
Well, when you go through, even if you're getting paid, isn't it, you write the script, especially for a movie, and it sits there and you send it around, and that moment that it comes back and you realize, nothing. And
it's not a moment. They dangle you. Green light, red light, red light, green light, red light, green light.
Can you share, one or two plots of the scripts that you...
Cult Wars,
we did Cult Wars. You know, do you remember back with the Hare Krishnas and the Moonies and...
Oh, sure, yeah.
All of that. Well, we wrote a movie called Cult Wars because we knew that the cults hated each other and were vying for devotees.
Uh-huh.
Devotees. They called themselves devotees, but they were devotees.
So this was kind of based on... the structure was that of kind of a gang war movie.
Like Warriors.
No, actually it sounds more like Spike Lee's School Days in a manner of speaking.
Spike Lee wasn't anywhere in those days.
That probably
Spike Lee didn't exist.
He was an embryo. Yeah.
So that got very close to being made.
That was green lighted.
And Michael Cimino's movie,
Heaven's Gate killed us.
Bankrupted the studio.
He was getting outside the studio at the front stairs, and just then this guy came by with a dolly, and the dolly was filled with cans of film. And we said, "Oh, what's that?" And he said, "Oh, Michael Cimino's going to give it another thing at home, and give another pass at it to put it together." Blah, blah, blah.
Oh man!
So the cloud, that little cloud that appeared on the horizon, became a really twister in no time.
Oh my gosh, that's a...
Stood us up.
Have you written... in the past decade, have you even been part of that merry-go-round, or did you kind of climb off and do other things with just voices and children's books?
The last movie we wrote, which has not been made...
Which is sold.
Which is The Vikings.
You've heard of The Vikings?
The Vikings. Okay, yeah.
Yeah. And that was to tween Viking girls who want to be heroes. Borghild and Hedvig.
And the guy who bought that, the family who bought that, the two, the husband and wife, he's currently directing the Kung Fu Kid in China.
Oh, okay. But that won't, is not going to get made either, or is that just on the back burner?
I think it's on the back burner now.
Oh, okay.
And the pilot light is out.
The Vikings, interesting.
Vikings.
Were you on Food Network or something like that?
Don't I wish.
Oh, you saw the sardine rare bit on YouTube?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, and that was what?
I paid for 20 cents. And I paid it.
Let's start at the very beginning.
Whether you're at the very beginning, the middle, or the end of the Broadway season, everything you need to know about Broadway, off-Broadway, cabaret, opera, and dance is in the pages of Performing Arts Insider Theater Magazine, available 21 times a year or just in the monthly edition. Either way, Dave's Gone By listeners get 10% off. So subscribe now to Performing Arts Insider and find out all the information at performingartsinsider.com.
Hi, this is Alfa-Betty Olsen.
And I used to be Marshall Efron.
And you're now listening to...
Days Gone By.
I want to talk to Marshall about some radio stuff, and I also want to talk to Alfa-Betty more about the producers, because we never really did...
Very big news about her and the producers. You know, she basically co-wrote the movie. She still did the typewriter.
Now, hey, this is serious now. I mean, it's one thing to be there at the typewriter and do a little editing, but are there any jokes that you personally can take credit for?
Go ahead, Alfie, tell it.
Well, I think I'd just rather not go there at this time.
Okay, don't go there.
I will tell you one story, though, from the producers.
Okay.
And that's, you know what, the big scene at the end where the fountain that comes up?
I love that, yes.
Well, the producers were shot on a very low budget, and it was, you know, kind of, and it was in New York City, and we were shooting in a studio on 26th Street, on West 26th Street, and at that time, we did not have any location for that scene. It was supposed to be the parachute jump at Coney Island. But the parachute jump had not been functioning for a couple of years, and when they tried to rent it, it turned out it was going to cost a ton of money to get it working again. And what was supposed to happen? Oh, and this was my idea. What was supposed to happen? If you remember the old parachute jump, when you hit the top, there would be this jerk, and then there would be this very fast downward until the parachute opened.
Hmm.
And then you were left kind of hanging under the open parachute. So he was going to say, at the top of the world, Ma, which was an homage to Jimmy Cassidy
in
White Heat. And then suddenly they were going to drop through the frame really fast. And anyway, so there was no place for this scene to happen. And also there was another thing that was lacking, which was a song for the audition sequence. Because, which was supposed to originally have been, everybody was going to sing a portion of I Could Have Danced All Night.
As
he wanted too much money for the rights to that song. So I went up to Lincoln Center to the library up there, the theater library, to try and find something in public domain that could be used for the audition sequence. And I walked past the fountain, and I said, oh, maybe that'll work. And came back downtown. And I told Mel about it, so when the shooting for that day was over, we got in a cab, and we drove up to Lincoln Center, and Mel looked at the fountain, and he said, okay, we'll use that.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's one of the most beautiful scenes in the film.
That turned out to be a great scene in the film.
And a signature moment.
Yeah, I mean, they repeat it. We mentioned that it's at the end on the credits, but it's also right smack in the middle of the film when Leo says, I'll do it. And the,
right.
I mean, it's beautiful. It's moving, actually. And funny.
And then he runs around, and that was really slippery. he runs around the edge of the fountain, and that was a wonderful shoot, too.
And you were there for the shooting of the... You weren't just there for the writing, but you were there for the shooting as well.
Yes, and the editing.
Oh, so you were really a collaborator on this whole thing. Because I remember reading, because everybody on some level also wants to take credit for a masterpiece, so I remember reading Ralph Rosenblum's book. He was the editor, I believe, on the film.
Yeah.
And he wrote a biography of himself, an autobiography. And according to him, if it weren't for him, the producers would never have left the editing table, and Annie Hall would never have left the editing table, and he sort of saved all these movies, which I guess there's some truth in that. But, you know, you also got the feeling like, okay, Ralph, you know, you're great, but you didn't write the thing, you know.
He and Mel did not get along, and it was difficult for them, for both of them.
Hmm.
You know, Ralph was very involved, and at that time, movies were supposed to be very kind of visual. You know, it was people running through the fields with the daisies waving, and there was a lot of that kind of stuff going on. And Mel is really interested in getting the punchline, you know, to be where it has to be, and to get the hard laugh. So they were, at odds. They had different goals.
And also the first half hour of the film is office bound. It could be the first act of a play. There's no room to go. It's two people in a room. And it's wonderful, but I can see a visual-oriented editor going berserk at that time of and saying,
right.
You gotta cut this.
And Mel only wants, you know, the hard jokes.
Any other... I'm sorry to leave you sort of out of the conversation, Marshall, but the producers is the producers.
I'm opening a vein right now.
Any other memories or thoughts of being there throughout the whole making of really the greatest comedy of all time?
Well, you know, it was, I said this before, it was like a home movie. Nobody was paying any attention to us. Oh, and you know what else we did? Every night we went to Max's Kansas City for dinner.
Max's Kansas City? Wouldn't that have been rock and roll and the Velvet Underground playing there and paper?
Well, Max's Kansas City really started as a place for artists. The rock and roll came in its latter days, very much latter days.
Okay, because producers were 69, 70.
Amazing place ever.
Yeah.
And I was there, only Alfa-Betty and I didn't know each other, and I'd be in the back room, and I don't know where she was.
Oh, what was? She was up there with Mel Brooks and Zero Mostel.
I wouldn't have known Mel Brooks, who the hell he was.
Well, you would have known. Was Zero difficult?
Nicky didn't. Nicky Ruskin, who owned Max's, didn't. He told me later, he said, you know, I just thought he was a funny guy.
Hmm. Was Zero Mostel difficult on the shoot, or was he a pro?
He was medium difficult. He had been in an accident, I think the year before, and his leg had been crushed.
Oh.
And then kind of put back together. So there were moments when that was it. You know, he couldn't go any further. Do you know?
Right.
The premiere of The Producers was at a suburban theater in Philadelphia.
Uh-huh.
And with no advance publicity or advertising to speak of. And so we went down early in the morning on the train to Philadelphia. And Mel did a radio show and a television show to try and publicize it.
Uh-huh.
And the host of the television show, and Mel was terrific. I mean, he did imitations and all kinds of things. And the guy got very excited, the host of the show, and he said he was going to come to see it. And so we went to the theater. There was hardly anyone in the theater, and it was very cold.
Oh.
And Joe Levine and a couple of the guys from his office came down in a limo. And we sat in the theater. And
the movie played.
You know, it was just great to see it on a big screen. And suddenly Mel said, nobody's laughing.
Well, it's toughness.
Looked around and, no, nobody was laughing.
All eight people in the audience.
Right, yeah.
Right. Anyway,
tell what the movie was that was playing with it.
Oh no, it followed a movie called Helga, a film of childbirth. I'm not making it. That was the movie that preceded it.
That was the second biggest comedy ever.
Anyway,
made.
Then when we went to leave the movie theater, the host of that television show cut us dead. He walked past us.
Oh.
We were the biggest losers he'd ever come across. I don't know.
Oh, man. Well, at least he showed up, but I guess he was.
And the people from Joe Levine's office got in the limo and drove away, and then we had to figure out how to get back to New York.
Oh, that's... sweet. That's nice.
So what you did? What you did?
Oh, and so then we found a drugstore. We called a cab. We got to a late train, and the car that we were in was filled with these guys who'd gone to Philadelphia to see a wrestling match.
Oh, no.
And they were big fans of Gorilla Monsoon. And Gorilla Monsoon's big number as a wrestler was the airplane spin. He would pick somebody up, and then he would go in a circle really fast.
Yeah.
And over his head. And one of the guys in the train was trying to do that.
Oh, God.
Reenacting the fight. And they loved it so much.
And we just sat there and stared out the window.
Oh, what a... On the premiere, well, one premiere of that's, oh my gosh. But at what point did you, I know you don't want to say bad things, but why did you have a fight with Mel Brooks? Did you suddenly feel it wasn't funny?
There were a lot of things. It just, there were disagreements.
Oh, okay.
Stuff.
When you saw the film, even though people weren't laughing, did that change her notion of the movie. It's like when Groucho Marx never liked Duck Soup because it was a flop, because America wasn't ready for an anti-war satire, just as they were ramping up for World War II. Was watching the movie in those early stages, did that suddenly throw a panic of doubt of saying, well, we thought this was funny, but guess it's not?
No, I just loved every minute.
Oh, good. Oh, good.
But Mel recently, we talked about this fairly recently, and Mel said when he got home from the train, from Philadelphia, he didn't sleep.
Mm.
And he and Ann just sat up, and she tried to make it, you know, pep him up and feel better, but he was really, really depressed.
And was it when it finally opened broader, or did it take the Academy Award to change things around? I mean...
Yeah, yes, but I don't think it ever cumulatively ever really made that much money.
Well, not just about the money, but the realization that, at the very least for a cult audience, from start to finish, it's the funniest movie ever made.
Somebody looks for a cult audience. You know, I think, oh boy, well this is going to be for the cult.
If it weren't for cult audiences, I wouldn't be here.
Except, wait a minute, except for our old friend, Paul Bartel.
Oh, Paul Bartel!
Always aimed at...
Paul always aimed at the cults. I'm going to make another cult movie. Oh, right, after Lust in the Dust. Didn't you do it?
We lost him a few years ago, but Mary Warrenov is alive, or are they both gone?
Mary's gone. Mary's still here.
Mary's still here. Better get that one straight. So, Marshall, I'm sorry to keep you silent for so long, but now it's your turn. Now I want to hear about your years in...
I have nothing to compare.
Well...
No, I've opened a vein, and I'm enjoying it.
Oh, is it messy? You were the sloppy Smurf. So I guess that makes sense.
I'm a Sloppy Smurf. I enjoyed that. And the Transformer and Scooby-Doo. And I just did a lot of kid video. I did a lot of TV.
But you were doing freeform FM radio in...
Yes, sir.
Back in the late 60s, the early 70s? When?
Starting in the late 60s when I moved to New York from Pittsburgh, PA.
And, I mean, do you have any specific amazing memories? Because radio is very close.
None whatsoever. None. I don't remember anything.
All right, well, and you know,
I'll tell you one thing. Paul Krasner and I did this with Bridget Potter. We this is 1968, and at the time, there were big sit-ins at Columbia University, so we pretended...
This is anti-Vietnam War.
Yeah, we pretended to be Columbia students and had taken over the radio station BAI.
Right, that's on your Wikipedia bio. That
played Judy Collins records. And cops kept coming. The cops kept coming. No, it's just a gag. It's a gag. Don't you get it? It's a gag. A hoax. Damn you.
Did you get into trouble for it, or was it just...
They kept coming. The cops kept coming. We said, no, it's a gag.
Yeah, and there were people listening in who really thought it was real.
Yeah.
And who alerted the police.
Yeah. It was great.
It's war of the college world,
and
I
NBC
guess.
Called it the first-rate hoax. We loved that.
Well, were you hippies-ish, or were you just trying to get by as artists, or...
What do you mean?
Politically, like in that time, it was a very...
I'm political. I'm a lefty.
Okay.
Well, Marsha, you were a founding yippie.
I'm a founding yippie.
Seriously?
A party, yeah. Well, I worked at City Lights Bookstore early on in my youth.
In San Francisco?
Yeah, San Francisco. I was rescued by Lawrence Ferlinghetti. I have a lot of history. I'm the legendary one. I'm a legend, I tell you. A legend.
But wait, you weren't in the Chicago 7.
No, I wasn't. I wasn't even in Chicago. I was on Broadway at the time. I wasn't going to leave my Broadway job on Broadway as an actor.
Wait, what?
And mess around in Chicago with a bunch of losers.
that's very right-wing sound.
I was in a hit show.
What show?
Saturday, I was shaving, and I heard that we'd won the Pulitzer Prize. That's what I like.
Wait a minute, what Broadway show were you in?
Great White Hope.
Really? Was that the one with James Earl Jones and...
I would like to thank you. I'd like to think so, yes.
What did you play?
I was Ragashi, the Hungarian impresario.
Oh my gosh, I did that.
I had a good time on that, and I was over on the radio, and I'd leave the theater,
uh-huh.
Put on my boots, and I'd go over to the radio station and be on the radio for a long time at night with Bob Fassler's Deep Post. And then I'd go home and sleep, and then get up and then do the matinee if it was a matinee day, or there. I got the attendance award.
Well, No, that's a very exciting time. That must have been, I'll bet that's one of the highlights of being able to be on Broadway, then go do some radio and live that New York life. I'll bet that was one of the best times of your life.
A couple of times. I was also in the hit on Broadway later on when we did Much Ado About Nothing, the Shakespeare production.
Who was the director?
I was in the park first, in Central Park, and then with Sam Waterston and Kathy Widows. And I've been in some classic movies. I did THX 1138 with George Lucas directing, and Bobby Duvall is the star. And I did Much Ado, I Bang the Drum Slowly.
Do you prefer TV or movies?
I prefer a job.
Okay.
Listen, if anybody listening wants to send me some money, I'd prefer that. I'd love that. Any of your listeners, all four of them, if they want to send me $20, I'd accept it. They send it care of you, and then you can forward it to me.
Well, I take 15% because, you know, I
don't take any percentage you want. Take 80%. I don't care.
Well, let me ask you. It's a fair question. You guys have been, as we said, about at this job for 30 years. You've done TV, you've done movies. You should be getting are you able to live comfortably if you never work again?
Yes.
Just from residuals?
We live very happily.
Great.
Well, we just did had a reading of a musical that we've been working on for a while.
Yes, at the York Theater. That's what made me think to call you in the first place. And thank
okay.
you.
Wow. All right.
Yes.
What about this? And you let us go this far without mentioning it?
Sorry.
Oh, the scandal.
No, because I always thought about interview, and then I get on to other things, and then I saw suddenly from, it was the York Theater, right? And I saw,
yes.
Oh my God, a Marshall Efron and Alfa-Betty Olsen musical? I gotta get in touch with them. And it was through the York Theater.
Why didn't you?
I did, I am, now.
That was an absolutely thrilling experience.
The show turned out great, really great. I mean, surprised me, delighted me. I'm enthusiastic.
Well, what is it? What is it called, and what's it about?
It was called Sin City Fables, and it was originally, it started because we wrote a book of fables called Sin City Fables.
Can I just interrupt for one second?
Yeah.
Sure.
If your audience, both of them,
yes,
can go to ABE, that is on Google. Go to Google and then do ABE, that's Advanced Book Exchange. And then go Olsen Efron, OLSEN/Efron, EFRON. And then they can see all the books that we wrote, and they can purchase Sin City Fables from one of the bookstores.
Do you have a stock in that company or something?
But this is the
story. No, we have nothing to do with them. I like them.
Oh, okay, no, it's cool. Because everybody else has
story.
Amazon and so, yeah, okay.
Go ahead.
Yeah.
I went over to the Bottom Line. This is a while ago. I went over to the Bottom Line with Paul Bartel on a Monday night, which was a night devoted to writers reading what they had written.
Uh-huh.
And I got the idea that Marshall and I could read Sin City Fables. So,
and do a better job than those that were performing.
Yes. So we did that. And then we started to read the fables on the performance art circuit. Sometimes we'd make as much as $35 for a night.
Okay.
And the audience response was really good. And at that point, we thought we really should do something more with this. Oh, also, we were plagiarized.
What?
By another performance artist who ultimately did it at some festival at Lincoln Center.
Wait, who's this?
Here in New York.
We don't want to mention her name because that would be wrong to do, but let's just say that she used, what are the inflatables? Large rubber inflatables.
But anyway, so...
Some of the most performance artists.
We knew we had to do something.
Yeah.
So we wanted to get music, and we fastened on Fran Landesman, whose big song, two big songs, are jazz classics. One is Spring Can Really Hang You Up the Most, and the other one is The Ballad of the Sad Young Men.
Hmm.
And she's been living in London for a really long time. So we went to London and talked her into being our lyricist. And she's been working with a composer named Simon Wallace for a while. So Simon is the composer.
Okay.
And we're just totally thrilled that we're working with those people.
And the songs came out beautiful, just beautiful.
So is there a next step?
Well, that's what we're waiting to hear.
We don't know.
That's what we're waiting to hear. We had a wonderful director, Stuart Ross, who wrote and directed
And created.
And created.
Forever Plaid, right?
Plaid.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, which ran forever. So.
Well, I'm so glad that it went so great for you guys. And unfortunately, I kind of have to wrap this up, but this is just...
No. Let's keep talking. We'll maybe get an audience for you.
Yeah, a third person, maybe, yeah.
Not to me.
Let me ask also, Marshall, you're what, 70 now, 71?
I'm 47.
Well, you don't look it. Let me tell you.
I know, I don't look it. I look a little older, but I am only 47, and I started in television when I was 4.
But here's the question, and feel free not to... Well, I hope you'll answer it, because it is a worrisome thing. We figure that you are not a svelte person, and I imagine you don't necessarily have the healthiest eating habits and other...
I do. I'm very good.
Are you really?
I'm a very good boy, yes. I finish my plate.
But, I mean, are you worried? I mean, you've made it
no,
to...
No, I have no problems. I'm a happy boy. I just want to lose some weight, that's all.
Can you?
I've always been chunky. Yeah.
Well, there's no. You're more than no. I mean, you're more than that, and that's
no,
why.
No. I'm less than that. You saw the sardine thing. That's me at my apogee.
Right. Oh, did you lose
Marshall
a lot of?
A bit thinner than he was when he did the
sardine. Yeah, I am a bit thinner.
Oh, that's wonderful. I'm very glad to hear. Are you consciously trying to lose more, or are you like a comfortable?
I always want to lose more. There's never an amount that I want to have more. I want less.
Because I think I remember.
Yeah, I am.
Running into you guys on the street like 15 years ago, I mean, you know, you're kind of hard not to spot. And you're just trying to say, hi, I'm a great friend. I remember you walking with a cane back then. Or maybe it was just kind of a...
My ankle.
A visual. Oh, it was an ankle thing.
I had surgery on my ankles.
Oh!
And the doctor cut me open and they put metal plates in my ankle. That's why I had a cane.
Oh, I'm so glad.
I only had a cane like 1 or 2 days, and that was it. Unless it was not me. Unless it was someone who looked like me. It wasn't me because
right.
I didn't wear a cane that
often. Wait a minute. One last story.
Oh, yeah.
All right. We were also restaurant reviewers at one point for the Soho Weekly News. And the premise was that that restaurant reviewers really aren't anonymous. That everybody knows who they are.
Okay.
And so we said the restaurant knows who we are, and the Soho Weekly News had no budget anyway. So everybody knows who we are. So the restaurant invited us, and our little, the thing that went on top of the column said, even if they sent out for the food that they served us, we would eat it and we would report on it.
Okay.
They would eat everything, and they did.
Right. So we arrived at this restaurant, and they looked at us like we were crazy. Because they said, no.
You were just in here. We
right.
were.
We had imposters.
What? Oh, my God.
Who had gone to this restaurant and said they were us and had gotten a free meal.
And they didn't even look like us.
Yeah, because you guys are pretty, you know.
Yes, we are singular.
Yeah. And by the way, the one question that I guess I should have asked right up front, Alfa-Betty is such an unusual name. You might as well tell our listeners.
Made it up.
No.
It's birth certificate.
My parents are from Norway, and my father's name was Alf, A-L-F.
Uh-huh.
So my name is Alpha. And my mother's name was Borghild, but that's very difficult for Americans to wrap their brain around. So she always said, call me Betty.
Alfa-Betty.
So then I was called Alfa-Betty.
And then Paul Simon wrote that song. You can call me Alf, and I'll call you Betty.
Oh.
Well, he was our friend in those days.
Maybe you should have left me the jokes. I don't know.
No. I'm in charge. And
well,
I'm in charge.
Well, it has been wonderful to have both of you in charge of this interview. It's been... So people can...
Best interview you've ever had.
It's up there. I have to say, it's way up there. You guys have been fantastic. And everybody, go to A-B-E Books.
A-B-E, A-Books.
No, go to YouTube.
Oh, and go to YouTube also, look for Marshall, M-A-R-S-H-A-L-L, E-F-R-O-N, and Alfa-Betty will be behind him typing madly and wonderfully. I want to thank you so much for being so great in the day road. What was that? What?
You'll pay us? Give us the money now?
Loose connection.
It's been really a lot of fun to talk to you.
Well, yeah.
And it's wonderful that someone is interested.
Well, thank you, and really, best of health and best of luck to both of you.
Yeah, how about an audience?
And you
how
too.
How about the body and audience? Send us an audience. We want that. So we want that more than life itself.
If you're like me, you agree that television could always be a little more Jewish. Well, our prayers are answered. Rabbi Saul Solomon, that's me, hosts Shalom Dammit. I do Bible studies, sermons, pap smears, whatever I damn well want. See all the episodes anytime on YouTube.com. Shalom Dammit, it's Jewish and it's proud!
Dave's gone by.
Well, what a delightful way it's been to end the year in the neighborhood. Thank you so much to Marshall Efron and Alfa-Betty Olsen. Check them out on YouTube and also at ABE Books. All the wonderful stuff that they've done over the years and all the great things that they're doing even now. Thank you also to Jeff Goodman, wherever you are. I hope you're having a great time this new year. And, of course, to the Lefkowitz and Weil families for all their love and support. And to my beloved Joyce for all the great things that she does day after day. And thank all of you for listening, as you've been doing for the past 7 years. If you want to give me your suggestions and your thoughts, please write to davesgoneby@aol.com. That's also the address to find out about advertising on the show. And please check the website davesgoneby.org to listen to dozens and dozens of older shows free, absolutely free, in our archives, davesgoneby.org. Thank you to our sponsors, Hewlett Minuteman Press, the copy kings of Broadway, Performing Arts Insider, the Bible of Broadway, go to performingartsinsider.com, TotalTheater.com, with hundreds of theater reviews and feature stories, Fancy Schmancy Balloons for all your party decorating needs. Shouldn't your party be a fancy schmancy one? Call 516-797-3229 and ask for Jeff. 797-3229. And don't forget to watch Shalom Dammit, Rabbi Saul Solomon's show on YouTube anytime at all. Oh, and listen to Dave J's new music video. And you can see it too on YouTube. A very merry federal secular holiday. It's quite a lot of fun. Well, it's time to leave the neighborhood and the decade. But I'll be back in the new year with the 333rd episode of Dave's Gone By. Until then, don't miss your days going by. This is Dave Lefkowitz wishing you good night, a great year, and gone by.